we catching bits of it, we're on the way up, and the thing holding us back, the main thing that holds us back are tax system regulations. We have to find our way through it. As Blake mentioned, they issued an executive order to the cabinet agencies I'm ostensibly in charge of. You never quite know how much in charge y'all, but those that I'm in charge of, I asked them to review all the regulations that they have and to get rid of those that are outdated or unproductive or counterproductive, and to be very careful about suggesting any new ones unless they essentially be what the rotary four-way test is compared to all everybody's familiar with. That's supposed to say. But before I get to that, I want to tell you, I've told them to review several times in the last couple of years, I guess. And I think you really have to get up in the air and look down to see what a marvelous place this is. To see the water and the creeks and the river and all the ocean. It really is a fabulous place. And I'm reminded of Christy Todd Whitman's admonition years ago. We were at some sort of a meeting in Columbia. Governor of New Jersey for 8 years, and also served as head of the EPA under, I think it was H.W. Bush, for 3 years. And I was reciting the various attributes and assets in South Carolina, up in the tall buildings of the Capital City Club. And we were looking down, there's a beautiful capital, beautiful ground, there's the University of South Carolina, just beyond that. Owned by the saloon and the ball, just beautifully. We looked out towards the horizon. I said, we really do have it all in South Carolina. And she said, and I quote, yes, you do. I hope you don't mess it up. That's the main thing, I think, that we have to be careful of now. We are really on the way up. But we have to be careful not to put on the brakes, not to take any wrong turns, not to make any mistakes. And if we can use our heads, all of us think of it. I don't think there's enough state of country here that can keep up with in terms of prosperity and economic development. The numbers are already starting to show that, and have been for a number of years. We've had good leadership and we've been going up. I've got to tell you this little story. The thing about thinking big, and I may have told some of y'all this, since I'm a Republican, I was on the way to the Republican National Convention a few months ago. I was talking to my wife, Peggy. I said, Peggy, if you ever in your wildest dream see me introducing and nominating Donald Trump for president of the United States at Cleveland, Ohio, Republican National Convention, she said, I hate to tell you, but I've never seen you in any of my wildest dreams. That's my girl, all right. This is really not a dream. We've got it all. And there's not another state that has all the assets that we have for to build a thriving economy and take us into unmatched prosperity. A lot of other states have a lot of things, but none of them have all of the things that we have. I was in Washington, outside of Washington, Monday, in Maryland, at the Game Over Convention Center. Some of you may have heard, big place. And I was on a panel with the governor of Kentucky, and we had an audience of 3,000 people. And I was reciting these assets, trying to get them. The name of the thing was Select USA. It's a U.S. Department of Commerce, Wilbur Ross. And we had a little press conference after about economic development in South Carolina. But as I was reciting all these assets that we have in this state, my friend Eric Reeves, the governor of Kentucky, said he was sitting there listening on some of those things they had, but most of them were telling him. He was doing a lot of court. And he said, well, Henry's right. So South Carolina does have a lot of assets, but we have one that don't have. I went to him, what is it? He said, bourbon. We have bourbon. Here's what we have. We have three major research universities that work together on things. They enter into public-private partnerships. A lot of places don't have research universities. Needless to say, they don't cooperate with any strong, because that's where we really do need to concentrate. As you remember, that was started in 1961, and it's working like a charm. It just needs to get strong. And all of these companies that I talked to, the ones that are here, like Boeing and BMW and Mercedes and Schaeffler, and we have companies here, those names we've got to have, but they all say that that technical college system is one of the main keys to coming to South Carolina. What we've done, and this is something that Secretary Wilbur Ross noticed yesterday, when he said, on Monday, he said South Carolina's programs and its technical college higher education system are a model for the rest of the country. We have something called ReadySC. What is that? That is where people from our technical colleges will actually go to Germany or China or Japan or Italy or these places. They will go at no charge to the company. If the company is going to come here, establish permanent jobs, have good pay, good benefits, we will send people there and they will examine the factory, the plant, or whatever, and determine what it is that they need to teach the people in South Carolina in order to handle those jobs. And they'll advertise through the technical college network and all that, bring the students in, train them, and they'll actually go set up a place in the technical college where Mercedes or BMW or whatever it is can bring their equipment. And one I went to recently, they had Mercedes vans. I thought I was at the Mercedes plant, but I was at the technical college looking at it. They had these vans in there, and the students working on it, and had professors and teachers of all kinds, and it is high-tech stuff. But that's something that we have that I don't think anybody else has. We've also started an apprenticeship program. Well, if a program meets certain qualifications as designed by the U.S. Department of Labor, then that company can get a $1,000 per student tax credit under South Carolina law. President Trump just a few days ago issued an executive order saying that the Department of Labor should ease up on the requirements and let the businesses, let the industries design those qualifications to make it a little bit easier to get into that apprenticeship program. And what we're asking to do is have a federal tax credit as well on that. But that apprenticeship program in ReadySC are just off the scale as far as these other states are concerned. What else do we have? Port of Charleston, getting ready to go to 55 feet at high tide, but at mean tide would be 52 feet. What's that mean? That means we'll be the deepest one until either New York or Miami or North Virginia, if one of them, St. New York, New Jersey, is deeper than Minnesota. But we'll be ahead of them. Unless and until they do that. But with 52 feet of water, sometimes 55 feet, you get a pretty good rise in the high tide. So Miami doesn't have high and low tide, it's not much different. But in Charleston, there is. And that means that the biggest boats in the world can come in to our port. And when we tell people, well, we do have that port, but also we've got the quickest turnaround time in the country. The other day, a boat came in, it had 13,000 something containing something, came into the Wando terminal, and they loaded or unloaded 3,091 of them. They had five cranes operating, and they removed 4.5 containers per minute. That's cooking. They can't do that anywhere else. And also, they can put them on right now on the inland port line, which is the Norfolk Southern Rail line. As you remember, we had the first regular passenger train service in the whole country. The best friend went from Charleston to Hamburg, which, by the way, if you know, it runs up to the Savannah River. That's where Hamburg is, and the reason it did that was the traffic coming down the river. Charleston wanted to get it to come over to Charleston instead of going over the Savannah. Always been competition, and it still is. But we have that rail line running from the Port of Charleston up through Brea and then on to other points where it crosses I-85, the biggest heavily traveled routes in the country. And we announced just recently a new inland port, going up to 95, going up to Dillon County in Dillon. And that'll cross I-95. So we've got those two inland ports. None of the state has that. And as you know, we have the beaches. We have the beautiful thing that I'll tell you about a minute ago. Beaches on one end, mountains on the other. Plenty of electric power. Good news is our congressional delegation was successful yesterday in getting a bill through the House that will allow for a tax credit concerning construction of electric nuclear power plants. So that's a big factor in the two that are going up right now in Fairfield County and two going up in Georgia. Without that tax credit, they may not have been able to continue after the bankruptcy of Western House and Toshiba. But if everything is just looking so good, so all we have to do is not mess it up. But here's what my last point is this. Every one of these companies that I have a chance to talk to, one way or another, those that are here, those that are expanding here, South Carolinians already know this, but these people coming from outside somewhere, every one of them said, the main ingredient that convinced me to come to South Carolina was the people. They said, there's just something about South Carolina. They're different, friendly, they're strong, they're smart. It's that friendliness, that openness that is different, and it counts. It makes a difference. So that's what we are. That's what we have. So what we must do, as I see it, we have other things. We have to protect the environment. We have to be, as Christy Todd noted, among other things, we have to be sure that we educate the children. We got a lot of work to do. But something that we can do right now, something that is not planting a seed that's going to take years to produce results, is keep those regulations down and keep the taxes low. That's a guaranteed formula for economic growth. And when you have economic growth, as everybody knows, when you have a job, when you have something to do, when you get up in the morning, you're happier, you're healthier. Domestic violence goes down, drug uses go down, you've got opioid crisis, that'll go down, it's working, everything. The more marriages, fewer divorces, I mean, everything gets better. So that is the number one, as I see it, is the number one immediate priority, and that is encouraging this economic growth. And the key to it now, finally, is we need a little bit of cultural change, because for so many years we've been taught and encouraged to go get your 4-year degree in whatever course or whatever area of study, that's the ticket to the future. Well, it may have been then, but it's not now. Now we've got new kinds of jobs, and nanotechnology, digital age, all of that is creating all sorts of new jobs. And these big plants I've been to, they say, if you hear this most everywhere you go, they say, we don't, our maintenance technicians don't have toolboxes anymore, they have laptops. It's changed. A long distance truck driver can make $100,000 a year to get that certificate from the Texas College. A nuclear welder can make $125,000 a year. An aeronautics mechanic works on the plane that I came down here, the average salary is $75,000 a year. We have young people getting out of technical school, and in a couple of years, they're buying a house. It's remarkable. So we have to be sure that parents, especially, that there's a new way to success. And that's this workforce is highly sophisticated, highly technical. It takes a lot of training, but it works. The new tools, the new technologies, and that's the way that I see it. Happy generations, our children, their children, their children. We just don't want to mess it up. So that's my story. So I'm here to learn. We have somebody to be writing down the suggestions of regulations that need to change if you know some. We've concluded, Governor Haley did a good job at this in studying and finding out regulations that needed to be changed, and they found some. What we're doing is taking one more step, building on that, to ask the people that have to deal with face to face. You may know a lot more than somebody else who doesn't have to work on those committees. If you can't think of it now, write Bill up and send it to me. Because we want to be as thorough as we can, and that's why I'm here. So I'll be glad to answer any questions anybody has. If you want to say.
microphone and then return to your seat for the response. We look forward to a great and productive conversation. Come on up. I know that our municipalities have been talking a lot about business licenses and what that means for cities. And maybe you can understand how that will play out for administration.
Okay, that's such an easy question. I'm going to ask one of these legislators. That's, we hear a lot about whether it should be some sort of standardized permitting and licensing, centralized, maybe with the Secretary of State. I don't know all the answers to that. I'd like to hear what people have to say. I know that there are a lot of people doing work that it's quite difficult to go to all the different permitting offices that they have to go to in order to get the licenses for different parts of the permits in different parts of the state. Any comment on that?
It's difficult.
Okay.
And yes. I'll just try to talk loudly. So I'm Stephen Murray. I'm on Cooper City Council, and I'm the chairman of the Houston County Economic Development Corporation. Also, in two small businesses here in town, deal with business license offices. I think most of the municipal councils in town agree with the goal of standardization, which is why many of us have followed the Municipal Association guidelines for standardization. A few examples of that are the standardized application, the standard filing deadline, the standard NAIC classification codes, moving things online so you don't have to go to a physical office. And I think one of the benefits that have happened out of the General Assembly talking about this issue is it's forced more municipalities to take a look at it, where I think the numbers around 90 or 100 out of a couple hundred municipalities have moved towards standardization. So there has been some progress out of the political dialogue that's been happening. I think the concern with my municipal council hat on is that in the city of Beaufort, for example, we're at 20% of our general fund money comes from business licenses. And there is a concern that if the control goes to the state, that it would erode that percentage of revenue that comes to us. And no offense to the General Assembly and to the state, but when we have turned control of local money over to the state, it always comes back a little bit lighter than what was promised in the initial deal. And I point to local government funds as a perfect example of that. Since 2008, that has not been fully funded. The municipalities are willing and ready to take care of some of the state assets that the state is not willing and able to take care of. The city of Beaufort, we estimate we spent somewhere between $700,000 and $1 million last year taking care of state assets. But we ask that you not tie our hands in how we generate revenue if we're also going to be asked to take care of those assets.
Thank you. He's qualified. Any other comments on that one? Another question, idea, suggestion? Yes, ma'am. There's one. Come on.
Okay.
Yes.
Hello. My name is Mayor Decker. My husband and I in the house today, fishing in charters. And before I ask you my question, and I ask them to give you, I just want you to know that in the last hour, I was told that you were, in regards to my question, totally for it and completely against it. So I'm not really sure what your actual position is, but seismic testing and drilling off our coast, what is your position on it? Thank you. I would like to give it to you.
Ma'am?
I was hoping to persuade you. Yes.
Governor, I'm the chair of the county, and I want to echo the sentiments
we don't want to have, we don't want to be known.
The big issue is that the larger issue with the 10.5% industrial property tax is that if you're a large manufacturer coming in with at least $2.5 million in capital investment and a certain number of jobs, you know, incentives can be given where it slashes at 6% right off the bat. But for smaller manufacturers, and especially for Beaufort County, where I think where we're going to be most successful is attracting the secondary and the tertiary suppliers, folks like Boeing and Volvo and Mercedes and Gulfstream to our neighbors in the South. It's a big disadvantage because we can't get those folks because we're not able to give them the incentives that they're able to get in Georgia or North Carolina, and the 10.5% is a huge burden.
Yes, sir.
Governor, my name is Mike Covert. I'm a county councilman in Beaufort County. I also own a small business. A couple of comments. The first one is about legislation. While I appreciate councilman that just spoke, and I agree with a lot of that, I'm going to look at this. My comments, first of all, from a small business perspective. We're not here as people who you know, own IBM and Goodyear. We're business owners that make this our home. We're small guys. I own a business that's not a storefront. We operate in your house, in her house. We operate in two states. In the state of Georgia, I carry one business license. I operate anywhere in the state of Georgia. In South Carolina, I have two walls in my office that are full of business licenses. Not only
is it
not only is it expensive, it's very expensive. I don't mind sharing this. I spend over $20,000 a year in business life. I can employ one person a quarter of a year to do nothing but follow business license renewals through all municipalities and counties in this state. Not only is it that, it's also time consuming with the loss of revenue because I'm chasing each county. What are your rules? What are your rules? So while I understand that a portal system isn't 100% cracked, that comes out like one of the roads. But the system, and I'm going to use Georgia, and I use very, very seldom, that system is working. One payment, they take care of it. The local counties in South Carolina, everyone is completely different. It's a burden, quite frankly. I hear comments from my constituents, other business owners in my community, that has said to me, and I point this as well, South Carolina, typically Beaufort County in my instance, is business unfriendly because there's so many restrictions on licensing, impact fees, permits, that we've got four municipalities and an unincorporated county. My other comment to you, sir, is about what you said earlier with technical colleges. My business happens to be one of those that benefits from technical college and the student that comes from there. I would like to ask, while it is the responsibility of the House and the Senate to appropriate and design budgets and funds, I feel like the buck stops with you, sir. The TCL, the technical college system, small colleges like USCB here in Beaufort, Chappahatchee, et cetera, they are not funded near the capacity that they need to be, that they have to be. We all want to see South Carolina and Beaufort County grow and prosper, and as much as anyone, but without funding for those technical colleges and small universities, it's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. They have relied and asked the counties for their input. Fortunately, this year, Beaufort County has changed the funding for both TCL and USCB from a flat rate, if you will, to based on the yield. They're going to see an increase, but it's not anywhere near the capacity that they can deliver a product for people like me, for the small business, and can put people to work to take care of your house, your business, and so forth. And then finally, I'd like to refer to my friend Senator Davis, who's been such a
up on Jeff before. I think Tom Davis knows more about it than I do about exactly. Tom, do you want to answer that, the status right now?
Sure. About a year and a half ago, the permit was filed with the Corps of Engineers to begin the permitting process. The federal resource agencies have begun the whole public hearings. There is $3 or $4 million a year that gets spent in connection with permitting activities. It's typically a 4 or 5 year process, so you're looking at the year 2020, 2021 before the permits are in hand. After that, there'll be an RFP process where you go about getting private contractors and private equity to come in. So that is moving forward. Our challenge in the interim is to make sure that the supporting infrastructure is in place. That has to do with Highway 17 going in for the county bridge being expanded after the I-95. It has to do with Norfolk Southern and CSX rail lines being brought down, and all those things are being worked on as well. So it's moving forward. The General Assembly is appropriating sufficient funds, as is the General Assembly of Georgia. So I think it's on track. And certainly having the governor as a cheerleader for that and to make sure that it continues on track is important, because in too many instances, those that are in Charleston and those that are in Savannah see business going to Jasper County as being out of their pocket. And that's really not the case. What the case is that we would lose business in Norfolk or New York, New Jersey, or the golf courts if we don't expand that capacity in Jasper. So anything you can do to keep it on track would be appreciated.
I intend to do that. And it's, we crossed a threshold a few years ago where a lot of folks thought it was extravagant and unnecessary. But I think everybody realizes now it could be, it will be a great asset in the northern area and those kind of things. As far as the Georgia system, my question is, when they have one license in Georgia, do they send any of that money back to the counties, or what do they do with the money?
When I pay the state of Georgia, for
some drift away between the legislature and the municipality association, but it's clear to all parties that the municipality association will be very, very, very more closely involved with this bill.
One thing I like to remember when we had these kind of discussions is the statement that Jack Kemp made years ago. Y'all may remember him. He said, we need to be not in the business of managing scarcity, but creating abundance. And there's some blankets that just won't cover the whole bed. And you pull it off with one side, you get it on you, and you pull it off to somebody else. Assuming that everything that we spend tax money on is a good thing, and there's nothing that can be cut out. Assuming that, which is a pretty big assumption, I think. Well, there's just not enough money to around everything. It's difficult making these decisions. But I think that sounds very promising. I look forward to discussing it more with you and getting that done. I think we're about out of time, are we? Yes? We have one more, maybe?
We've got time for one more, Governor.
One more.
Governor, you touched on it in your opening about the digital economy and innovation economy. You know, we've been wildly successful at attracting advanced manufacturing, which I think will carry us a long way away. But there are emerging economies around innovation, around technology, around research and development and software. You know, Charleston's being called by some in Silicon Harbor. Brookings Institute put Charleston number 12 in first round rankings of startups last year. A lot of exciting things happening in very small regions of the state. How would you and your administration support the broadening of the innovation economy and digital economy throughout the rest of the state?
What we do with these, we got a great commerce secretary with Bobby Hitt. He's got a great staff over there, they're very knowledgeable, they've been around a long time. We got various economic development groups in the counties. But we can show what we have, and we can recommend this and that, and take a good look at this, but ultimately it's their decision. They'll go where they want to. But what I say again, the underlying understanding of all of these companies that I've spoken to, I've done a lot in the last 3 or so years, is there's always the people, the quality of life. And I promise you, if they get up and you can fly in here like I did a little while ago, they'll come here. Y'all get it all through my plane. And then they'll ride around. That Main Street, what's the name of the street? Jay Liz. Can't find that anymore. Paradise. And that's, I guess that's the thing. We